With his critically acclaimed books about agents and double agents during the Cold War, our next guest, Ben Macintyre, has topped bestseller lists all over the world. Ben Macintyre, welcome to the show. We saw some clips here of Oleg Gordievsky, and one of your books is about him and his very different career in the KGB, as he was an agent for the MI6 as well. Tell me, where is he right now? He's still alive.
Oh, very much so. Yes, he is in the safe house, which is the sort of spy term for his home. He lives under a different name. None of his neighbors know who he is. He lives under complete tight security because he is still at risk. He is still under an execution order that was passed by the Russians against him. He was court-martialed. So there is still an execution order outstanding against Oleg Gordievsky. He lives a life of solitude, really. He's under a different kind of lockdown from the one that we are all experiencing, but his has been going on for 35 years. And he is, in many ways, a prisoner of history.
What made him such a perfect agent?
He was a star of the KGB. He rose up through the ranks of the Soviet intelligence service at almost record speed. His father was a KGB officer. He was born into the KGB. He was born to do this job, and he was very good at it. But it was only really when he came to Scandinavia, to Copenhagen, that he began to realise... I mean, there had been doubts before, but he began to realise that the system, as he saw it, that he was serving, was a brutal, repressive, Philistine regime. He was particularly enraged at the fact that the high culture that he was able to enjoy in Copenhagen, in Denmark, he couldn't enjoy that in the Soviet Union. It was all incredibly restricted. And that began to turn him against... It took a long time, and it took another tour back to Copenhagen before he was recruited. But the Danish intelligence service were the ones who really started the recruitment of Oleg Gordievsky.
As he had this job for a very long time as a double agent, he never told his wife, did he?
No. No, I mean, that is the emotional core of the story, really, is that Oleg had to keep his secrets. And it wasn't that he didn't trust his wife, although towards the end he wasn't sure. He just felt he would have been putting her in too much danger if he had shared his double life with her. But you have to bear in mind that he was already a double agent before he met her. So their marriage was built, in a way, on a massive deception.
He didn't do it for money. He did it out of conviction.
He never wanted money. And in fact, he rejected any attempt to give him any money. He didn't want fame. He did it... All spies operate in a kind of complicated way. I've never come across a spy that didn't say that they had an ideological kind of higher calling, some higher purpose. Oleg is like that, but there are other elements to his personality. He was very ambitious. He was very adventurous. He enjoyed risk. Secrets, I've come to believe, are a kind of drug. And once you've tasted them, they are very addictive.
In general, how would you say, how much do you influence on world history would you say spies have had?
Well, that's a really good question, because I write about spies all the time. I've done something like 12 books on spies. But I have to admit something, which is that spies often don't make a huge amount of difference to the world. They can make traditional diplomacy better. They can provide secret information that's not available from public sources. But very occasionally, spies actually change the course of history. They actually strategically affect the way that states behave. And Oleg Gordievsky is one of those examples. The intelligence he was producing, because he rose up through the ranks and he became very senior in the KGB in London. And so he was able to tell the West, not just MI6, the British intelligence service, not just PET, the Danish, but the Americans as well, the CIA, what the Kremlin, what the deepest heart of the Kremlin was actually thinking. And it had a profound effect on the Cold War, because Oleg was able to reveal to the West that the Kremlin was genuinely convinced that Reagan was going to press the nuclear button. They weren't just imagining this. It wasn't just paranoia. They were convinced that was going to happen. And when Oleg explained this to his handlers, and it was sent back to Reagan and to Thatcher and to other leaders, you can see there was a change of direction. The rhetoric about the evil empire, about the Soviet threat, began to be ratcheted down, and you begin to see the beginning of the end of the Cold War. There's a strong argument that says that Oleg Gordievsky was a key influencer in bringing about what became the kind of collapse of communism. And he was able to do this in an extraordinary way. I mean, when Gorbachev came to visit London, this just to give you one example, a famous visit that Gorbachev made to London. So he drew up this briefing note, which, of course, was written by MI6. So you had a unique situation where one spy was briefing both sides. He was telling Gorbachev what to say to Thatcher, and he was telling Thatcher what to say to Gorbachev. And so when they emerged from that meeting, Thatcher said, "This is a man I can do business with." Well, the reason for that was that Oleg Gordievsky had rigged the business.
How action-packed is the day of a spy?
Most spying is very, very boring. And Gordievsky is a good example of that. I mean, his life, in some ways, what he was doing, bleeding secrets from the KGB and getting them to the West, was quite humdrum. I mean, it was a sort of day job. I mean, he would go out in the day and he would, you know, he'd take the microfilm with him, he'd hand it over to his case officer, then he'd go back and have lunch.
But how did that work? I mean, communication back then, because you didn't have the cell phones, you didn't have the computers. Well, how did they communicate with the other state?
Well, the way Oleg did it when he was in Denmark was that the KGB would send orders and instructions on microfilm to the KGB station in Denmark, physical microfilm, which would be bought in the diplomatic bag. So you couldn't break into it, although foreign powers frequently did, but you're not supposed to break into the diplomatic bag. So Oleg would take out the microfilm, the physical microfilm, he would put it in his pocket when he went for his lunch hour, he would go to a particular rendezvous site on a square in Copenhagen. There he would meet his British handler. They would do what is called a brush contact, where they would walk past each other, and surreptitiously Oleg would hand over this microfilm. Then the agent would have to run with it to a car parked around the corner. Then he'd have to run it through a special machine that he had that could immediately copy it. It was a special thing invented in the Q branch of MI6. Believe it or not, there is a Q branch of MI6, like Q in the James Bond story. It's for real, yeah, there is a Q branch. There still is. And they would run that through, they would copy it immediately, then he'd have to run back, hand it back to Oleg. Oleg would put it in his pocket, walk back into the Soviet embassy, and that all had to be done in about 25 minutes, 20 to 25 minutes.
Oleg ended up in Britain after a dramatic escape from Russia when it was about to be revealed. And his wife, she did follow, didn't she?
She did eventually. I mean, Leila's story is in a way a very tragic one. I mean, she had gone off on holiday with her two daughters. Oleg had not told her what he was planning to do. It would have put her and the two children in danger. That was what he said. I think there was also an element, and I've discussed this with him many times, that he didn't entirely trust her. He wasn't absolutely certain that if he told her, she wouldn't go to the KGB and turn him in. I asked her that question many times. She's also in Britain. And she said, and I said, you know, what would you have done if Oleg had told you? And she said, I would have given him 24 hours. So that wasn't a ringing endorsement. That wasn't her saying I would have stood by him, but it wasn't saying that she would betray him either. But she did eventually get up. Sorry.
Yeah, but you say she's still in Britain, but they are not married.
No, they're definitely not married. It took many years. I mean, she spent 5 years in the Soviet Union. She was effectively under house arrest. She was absolutely staggered when she was arrested, effectively, after Oleg's disappearance and told that he'd been a double agent. She couldn't believe it. And she had a terrible time in the Soviet Union. She lived a really difficult life there. And she eventually, the Berlin Wall came down, you know, as we know, glasnost and perestroika, and she was released. She was allowed to come to the West, and there were lots of sort of strange sort of photographs in the tabloid press in Britain of the two of them walking arm in arm in... And it was supposed to be a sort of symbol of reconciliation. Actually, the truth was that the marriage was shot. I mean, it was... How could it really have survived what had happened? And they managed to keep going for a little bit, but really the marriage was over. And they are... It's a tragedy, really, but Oleg is completely estranged, not just from his ex-wife, but from his children as well. I mean, these stories have an emotional cost. They're exciting and they're fascinating, but they are not cost-free. Somebody pays a price for these things. And Oleg's story is one of heroism in a way, but there are human victims in them. And I think Leila and his daughters are some of those.
Thank you so much, Ben. It's been wonderful talking to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.